Good morning. Please bow your heads for prayer. Dear God, we come before you today not out of habit, but because we love you, because we respect you. Please bless us as we come together to worship. Please help the pastor's words to be your words. In your prayer, amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath to everyone. It's good to see you here this Sabbath day. This, the last Sabbath of 2008. So next time we get together and worship together, it will be 2009. It's amazing, amazing. I want to welcome you all here, especially those of you who are visiting family or friends during the holiday season. A special welcome to you. To some folks who we haven't seen in a while, or welcome to, glad to have you here. I want to make one quick announcement. I don't see it in the bulletin. Just a reminder that next Sabbath, Friday evening here at the church at 7:30 p.m., we're having communion, as well as Sabbath morning here in the church for our church service. So we have communion twice next weekend with our pastor, Pete. So 7:30 p.m. Friday evening, as well as next Sabbath, is communion Sabbath here at College Church. You know, we have a tradition at our home when it's a birthday, that we don't just celebrate birthdays on that one particular day. I mean, you know, when a baby is born, the parents and the family aren't just happy that one day. They celebrate for a while. So even though we just celebrated Christmas 2 days ago, let's continue in that spirit. Let's continue in that warm feeling of Christmas and the celebration and the welcome of Jesus to our earth. Our head elder.
It's ironic that I saw Pastor Gracia here this morning, because he didn't know I was going to talk about him this morning. So I'm going to have to say something, some good things about him. Back in September, we had the departure of Pastor Gracia. He left in August, creating a void in the administration of the College Church. The Southern New England Conference, in its wisdom, assigned Pastor Emmanuel Joseph to handle the day-to-day operations here at the College Church. Pastor Joseph immersed himself in the culture of the College Church, in the administration, as well as the ministries of visitation, prayer meeting, and being part of the preaching rotation. Today is his last Sabbath as our interim pastor, and we want to express our thanks for his service and his ministry to us. Pastor, would you come forward? We want to thank you. That's the idea. We want to thank you for your ministry to us, and we wish you God's speed and blessings as you go on to minister to others.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you very much.
I'm glad you're here.
I really want to, first, I didn't know that. I thought you. But the doctor was talking about somebody else, you know. But thank you very much, and thank you to you for allowing me to minister to you. It's been a wonderful experience. And I'm sure that through the leading of the Holy Spirit, you have chosen the right person to lead the church, Pastor Pete. So we pray that the Holy Spirit will continue leading so that the year 2009 will be a blessed year for the College Church. Again, thank you very much.
We have one more thing that I must do before we sit down. Tomorrow is Sunday. Tomorrow is also a very unique day for a couple in our community. Tomorrow will mark the 50th wedding anniversary of Jim and Mary Lou Seeger. So when you see them, please congratulate them, and we go thank God for the blessings that they have given to us for the time that they've spent with us. Thank you.
Good morning. Today's call to worship is adapted from Luke 2. Please join with Alden and I in our responsive reading. I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace on earth to those whom God has pleased. I have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for all people. He is a light to reveal God to the nations, and he is the glory of your people. Let us see the things that has happened, which the Lord has told us about.
You may be seated. You know, we live in a day and an age of conveniences. That's the way our society seems to be going. I'm sure when I was a kid, I remember that McDonald's and Burger King and fast food restaurants had drive-ins. But as I got older, I realized that you could now drive up to the bank and access your machine at an ATM or a drive-up teller. Or you could go to the grocery store and you can now have self-checkout. Have you seen those things? You can check your own groceries out now. And I've also seen that with all these new pharmacies popping up, that they have drive-through pharmacies now. You don't even have to get out of your car. And then it hit me just recently that I realized that there was a place that not too far from where I live in Worcester, there's a drive-through dry cleaner. There's a drive-through dry cleaner. You don't even have to get out of your car. You just pull up your car, and right next to you, this door opens up, and they hand you your laundry right then and there. And I thought, how convenient is that? Of course, there are certain things that we do not substitute with convenience, right? There's no substitute for studying the Word of God and spending the time in the Word. There's no substitute for spending time with your children. There's no quick remedy or quick fix for that. But there was one convenience that I took advantage of this past week, I will admit, and that was paying my tithe and offerings online. Yeah, I just did that. On Christmas Day, actually, that night I sat down and I think it was Brother Williams. Who was it? Brother Williams, I think, last Sabbath told us about this online thing. So I jumped onto the church's website, and sure enough, there it was. I could pay my tithe and offerings online. I thought, this is convenient. This is one convenience I will take advantage of, especially if I'm away from home or something like that. But, you know, again, I think about all the conveniences that we've had in this world, in our society. But on a serious note, I also thought about some of the things that have happened this past year. Maybe reflect just for a moment some of the things that have happened to you this past year. And maybe some of the tough things come to mind. Maybe some of you have lost your job. Maybe some of you have lost your home. Maybe some of you have lost your marriage or lost a loved one. But, you know, there's always this one constant that's in our lives. And that one constant is the love of Jesus. The love of Jesus can carry us through anything. And the love and the support. I mean, we saw a lot of that over the past few weeks during this ice storm. The support, the camaraderie that folks have given to each other during these tough times. And so I appreciate so much the birth of Jesus, and I know you do too. Because as we've heard recently, it wasn't just a birth and we were celebrating a baby, but why did he really come? He came for you and for me. So it's just a small way that we can repay him and thank him for all that he has done for us. Our tithe and offerings this morning, our offerings rather, is for the Southern New England Conference. Our ushers will wait upon us now. Thank you. Father in heaven, how can we repay you for all that you have done for us? It would take more than eternity to do so, and so what we do today, what we've given back to you just now, is just a small way of saying thank you. But we also give you, Lord, more than just our offerings and tithes, but we give you our heart, we give you our minds, we give you our will, because we always want to serve you. We dedicate ourselves to you now. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
As the children come forward for the children's story this morning, they will be walking past you with their hands out and smiles on their faces, accepting offerings.
Those of you who still have dollar bills and $5 bills and $10 bills, wave them like this so that the children can see them. Okay, we're right over here. There's some behind you. Somebody needs to go backwards a little bit here. I saw something there. Oh, you've got to go back there. There's a lady back there that's got a dollar bill. Hold it up again. Tell you what, anybody else? I've worked for the church for 40 years. I value dollar bills. Okay. There we go. And I already scared one off, or else he's going up to the balcony, guys. He's coming up to the balcony. Okay. Did you have a good Christmas? You had snow, didn't you? I was down in Florida. We didn't have any snow. I was so disappointed. I called my friend Ian and I said, "Is there snow?" And she said, "Lots of it." And I got sad. Now I'm back. Bobby and Edith had received a special invitation to a children's Christmas party. They were so excited. They went and got the calendar that was hanging on the wall. They took it off the wall and got a big black marker, and they put a circle around the 24th of December. And then they drew little lines coming out of it to make sure that they wouldn't forget about the party. And Edith was younger, and she thought, "Oh, that's not quite enough. Sometimes I forget." She went over to the refrigerator and she put that invitation on the refrigerator and put a magnet on the front of it so that they would be sure to remember. the 24th of December. This was going to be a special children's Christmas party. And at the party, there would be a huge tree, a real tree, that would have red and gold and blue and green and silver ornaments on it. And underneath the tree, there would be lots of presents. They knew that that's what would be there. And so they were so excited. Now, Bobby was a little bit older than Edith. And Mommy and Daddy had already told Bobby, there won't be many Christmas presents this year. We don't have much money. Daddy's out of work. And so all you're going to get this year for Christmas are clothes. Don't you love it when you get clothes for Christmas? Yeah, that's such an exciting thing to do. Get clothes for Christmas. And Bobby said, that's okay, I'm a big boy now, I don't need any toys. But he was worried about Edith. Edith needed a doll. See, she didn't have a doll, and she needed a doll. Edith was sick quite a bit. And this year she had been sick a lot, so she had been in the hospital and out of the hospital. And Bobby was worried about Edith. And he had already decided what he was going to look for when he got to the Christmas party. He didn't want a toy for himself, but he wanted something for Edith, for his sister. The 24th finally came, and Edith was sick. She was so sick she couldn't get out of bed and go to the Christmas party, and so Bobby had to go by himself. He walked into the big room where the Christmas party was going to happen, and he looked at the tree, and he was surprised. Because all of the presents were in boxes. He couldn't tell what was in the box. How was he going to choose a present, a doll for his sister? He just was upset. And he sat there and he watched and he waited for his name to be called and he watched the other boys and girls going up and they would get their box, they would choose a box, and then they would go, while they were walking back to their seat, they would be opening it up to look inside, and there were all of these ooh noises as they got the presents out. So Bobby thought, God knows that I want to get a doll for Edith. I think I'll pray. And so he didn't close his eyes, but he prayed, Dear Jesus, you know that Edith needs a doll, and I want to get a doll for her. Help me choose the right box. And then he heard his name called. And he had been looking at the presents, and he walked up there, and he picked up the gold box. And he went over and talked with the lady and said, I don't want to open it here. I already know what's inside it. It's for my sister. I want to just go home. And the lady said, that's okay, you can do that. So he took the box and he went running home and went running straight up to the bedroom where Edith was in bed. And he took the box and he put it down on the bed in front of her and said, you don't have to wait till Christmas. You can open it now. And so Edith looked at that and her eyes were big and she saw the light shining off the gold and she thought, oh, wow, a present. Thank you, Bobby. And then she took the ribbon off and she opened up the lid and there inside was a little doll and a blanket for it. And she took the doll and she put it in the blanket and she wrapped it up very carefully. And then she hugged that doll. It was the first doll she had ever had. But she remembered, and she put the doll back down, and she reached over, and she hugged Bobby, too, and said, thank you, thank you, thank you. Have you ever gotten a surprise? Yes. It was a surprise to Edith, but it wasn't a surprise to Bobby. He thought he knew what was in there because he had prayed about it. The Bible is filled with surprises. We have a God who loves surprises. In fact, I think his favorite word is surprise, because it happens so often. You've studied Bible stories probably in Sabbath school and church school. You remember the story of Naaman? What happened with Naaman? Naaman was a general. He only answered to the king, but Naaman got sick. And God told him, you have to go to this muddy river, and you've got to jump up and down in that muddy river 7 times. And Naaman said, ooh, a muddy river. I don't want to do that. But he went over and he got in that water and he came out, nothing. What happened on the 7th time? I can almost hear God up there in heaven. When he came up that 7th time, God said, surprise! And the disease was all gone. Today, Pastor Bothwell is going to talk to us about our God of surprises. I want you to listen really carefully and see how many surprises he tells us about that God has done for us or is going to do for us, okay? Thank you for listening so well. You may go back to your seats.
Let us all stand.
We need your heart, oh God.
Let's come closer together as we kneel before our Maker.
Before I start praying, I'd like to, this morning I was told that Sister Steiner is terminally ill. As you may remember, Elder Steiner pastored this church and also was our conference president. So we'd like to pray for her, especially this morning. Father in heaven, we have come before you this morning with praises in our heart, coming to the end of the year 2008 and the last Sabbath of this year. We want to praise you, Lord, for all your blessings. We want to thank you for being so good to us. We want to thank you for being with us, Lord. We know that if we are still alive, if we could make it here this morning to eat, to fellowship, and to worship you, it's not because that we are better than others who cannot make it here or who did not see the end of this year, but it's because of your grace. It's because of your mercies. We want to thank you
for being our Father. We want to thank you, Jesus, for what you have done for us on the cross, for coming down in our midst, for taking upon yourself our misery, for sharing our lives, Lord, and for giving your life for us. So that today, not only we have the hope, but we have eternal life. We thank you. Lord, it's a privilege for us to be together, to praise your name, to worship you on the day that you have set aside for your children to remember that you are our Creator and the one who sustains life in us. So we thank you. This morning we pray once again that you will bless us as we listen to the words from Dr. Bothwell, that the Holy Spirit will put the words in his mouth, that you will inspire him, so that, Lord, today we can receive a blessing from heaven. Some of us have come, Lord, with praises in our heart to thank you for everything that you have done. Some of us have concerns. Lord, some of us are going through some tough times in their lives, Lord. Maybe some of us have lost their jobs. We ask, Lord, this morning that you will remember, you will remind them, Lord, that you are still their God and you still love them. At this moment, Lord, we want to pause and to remember those who are sick. We pray especially this morning for Neil Steiner, as the family members were told there is no more hope. But whatever happens, we ask at this moment that the hope of resurrection will shine more than ever in her heart. And may the family members be comforted to the thought that, Lord, you have already conquered death. And soon and very soon you will come. And those who have gone to sleep will come forth to be with their Lord. We remember, Lord, Grace this morning. We remember Amanda this morning. We remember our brother's father, Duncan, this morning. We remember this morning Kim, Peggy, and Laura Lee Williams. We ask this morning that you will touch them, Lord, because nothing is impossible to you. And we ask that those who are watching through cable television, Lord, you will bless them also. And we ask that at the end of this worship service, we may be able to say truly, we have been with Jesus. Hear our prayer, Lord, we ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. Our scripture reading this morning is found in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 15, 16, and 17.
So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold fast to the traditions that you were taught by us, either by word of mouth or by our letter. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and through grace gave us eternal comfort and good hope, comfort your hearts and strengthen them in every good work and word.
Amen.
Was the night before Christmas. It really was. And the weather outside was frightful. It really was. And I was sitting in Penn Station in New York City, waiting for a train to Washington, D.C. Penn Station is an amazing place. It is the world's busiest train station. But this evening, the crowd was small. Most people had already gone to where they were going to be the next day. Where I was sitting and waiting for my train, there was a big sign that said, no loitering, no sleeping, no just about everything that was on that sign. And then I saw an obvious homeless person come wandering in and sat down almost under the sign. Pretty soon, I saw his eyes grow heavy, and I heard his breathing get slow and deeper, and I knew he was in a better place than Penn Station. At least I hoped so. And then I saw him coming, one of New York's finest, in his blue uniform, with his belt and his gun and his wooden baton. And I saw him heading my way, and I knew what was coming. And he came over, and he stood in front of this homeless man, and he just stood there, and he took his wooden baton, and he is going like this. And I'm thinking, oh, no. And then he turned and walked away. And as he did so, he looked at me, and I mouthed the two words, thank you, to him. And he said to me, it's Christmas. Life is full of surprises. I love surprises. I don't think any of us really ever get too old for surprises. I have noted that as I have grown older, surprises have filled me with deeper wonder. I am totally surprised at how fast life has gone by. Wasn't it just last Sabbath that we celebrated the new millennium? 9/10 of the first decade of this millennium is gone. Not 9/10 of the millennium. Whew, that would be something, wouldn't it? We'd be old as Methuselah. 9/10 of the first century of this millennium is already our little planet has gone around the sun 9 times. My father was a school teacher, and in the evenings when he would come home, he would go straight to bed and get up in time to work the 11 to 7 shift in the Bethlehem Steel Company. And one night, as he was leaving and going out the door, he said to me, "I'll see you next year." And I burst into tears. I was shattered. But do you remember when you were little how a year was like forever? Do you remember sending off for stuff out of a cereal box and it would take like 6 weeks to get it, and 6 weeks was a millennium? And then my dad laughed and he said, "Well, actually, I'll see you tomorrow morning." He said, "It's New Year's Eve." When I left the seminary, I was so sure that I would never work for the church for 40 years. That was like impossible because Jesus was coming. We had all read those accounts, I think it was called Now by Mary Kay, that story that she had created about the second coming and all of us running and hiding in the woods, and I was sure that all of that was going to happen before I would be standing in front of you today, this old. I had memorized the last chapters of the Great Controversy. I had fantasized them. I had lived them over and over in my thoughts and my dreams. Wow. I must say, I am surprised to be here. I am surprised at how easy it is to think that we are better than other people. It's an infectious disease that is so easily caught. I really want to thank two young men who knocked on the door of my house, and I invited them in, and they shared with me their faith. And then they told me that my baptism wasn't any good, that if I was going to have a place in God's kingdom, I would have to be baptized into their church by one of them. I want to thank them because they helped me to understand just how obnoxious we can be when we try to witness our beliefs. And how utterly sick we can become by thinking that we are the chosen. I am surprised as a Seventh-day Adventist of how few of us really, really, truly believe that we are saved and already living forever. That amazes me. Jesus clearly says, "If you believe in me, you have already crossed from death to life. I hold you safely in my hand. No one can snatch you out of my hand." Jesus is so clear. He is so forceful. And yet, I know that some of you that are listening to me right now do not have the assurance of salvation. And I am surprised. I am surprised at how little joy there is in Adventism. We are the chosen frozen. We come to church. We deliver our tithe. We do all the things. But we're not really happy in church. If somebody lifts their hands in praise in our congregation, we go, "Oh, they've gone to the dark side." I am surprised at how many of us don't understand that the kingdom of God begins now. That it isn't a future event. That right this moment, we have already started to live forever. On a lighter note, I am surprised on a clear winter night, I take out my telescope and I point it out into the heavens, and as many times as I have done so, I am surprised at how big it is. Years ago, I read an article in the National Geographic about galaxies. And I'll never forget one of the sentences in there. It had described how our galaxy is with 100 billion suns is a medium-sized galaxy. And the one sentence that grabbed my brain is, galaxies, not suns, galaxies are as thick in the universe as blades of grass in a meadow. I remember this little cartoon strip of Peanuts where Charlie Brown is standing out and it's night and he's looking at the sky and there's stars and there were no words in the first panel. And then we went to the next and there were no words. He's still looking at the stars. And in the third picture, he's still looking at the stars. And in the fourth picture, finally he says, I have to go inside. I'm beginning to feel insignificant. Go, Charlie Brown. I am surprised at the joys of being a grandparent. It is so much fun to have them and so much fun to send them home. I am surprised this morning because do you ever get a song stuck in your head and it goes round and round and you can't get it out? It occupies. As I stand in front of you right now, I've got one of those songs going round and round in my head. And how ironic it is that it's, do you hear what I hear? Think about that one just for a moment. I hope you don't hear what I hear right now. I am surprised at how little I know, how little I really know at this stage of life. When I was 17, you should have known me then, I was smart. I knew stuff. When I was 17, I would interrupt, I would correct people because I knew stuff. But as years go by, I get dumber and dumber. And I don't think it has anything to do with the deterioration of, well, maybe it does. My big surprise this year is, well, when we started the fall semester and I saw the enrollment that we had at Atlantic Union College, I knew it was over. And my big surprise was Loma Linda University. And I now berate myself for being surprised. Because for the last 10 years, I've been praying, we've all been praying, that God would rescue Atlantic Union College, and lo and behold, at the last minute when he does so, I'm surprised. Shame on me. My very first year in the ministry, one of my church members had a baby that was born blind. And it was, of course, you can imagine the sorrow in our congregation. And as I tried to be a good pastor and tried to minister to these folks, I made the, you know, house call. And my heart was heavy. I didn't know, what do you say on such an occasion when a family has brought their newborn home and it is blind? And I rang the doorbell, and I heard the thunder of little feet on the other side. The older siblings came to the door, and they opened the door, and they saw me, and they shouted, "Mommy, Daddy, the pastor has come to make our baby see." Where is the nearest door to get out of here? And I felt myself sort of boxed in by these children, and I made arrangements then on Sabbath to anoint the baby. And we anointed the baby on Sabbath, and they took the baby home. And the next Monday evening, I got a telephone call, and there is ecstatic joy on the other end of the line. They had just come back from the baby's doctor visit on that Monday, and the doctor had turned to them and said, "I don't know what has happened, but this baby can see." And when they told me on the phone, the first words out of my mouth were, "You've got to be kidding." I am not a very good servant of my God. He surprises me day after day, and like a little kid, I just... I am surprised at how difficult it is to give away eternal life. It's hard to do. If I invented a pill that you would take and you would live forever, I could charge $100,000 for that pill. You'd pay it. You'd go and mortgage your house. You'd pay it. And yet I stand in front of you and I say, it's free. It's a gift. And people don't want to take it. I am surprised. I'm surprised at how clever Lucifer has been. Do you realize that Christianity is the most unique religion in the world? Christianity is the only religion in the world that salvation is a gift. Every other church, religion, or whatever it is, other than Christianity, you have to earn it. The old-fashioned way, you know. Christianity is not done the old-fashioned way. It's a free gift. I am amazed in Adventism when I hear people say salvation is free, and then comes the inevitable but. As soon as you say but, you have perverted Christianity into the pantheon of false religions that Lucifer has produced around the world. I am surprised at the clarity of Scripture on all of these issues and how complicated we have tried to make it. The Sabbath. In Hebrews, Paul clearly states that the seventh-day Sabbath is a symbol of rest from works so we can be saved by grace. By our being here this morning, we are celebrating not only creation, but we are celebrating the fact that because Jesus died for us on the cross, we now can rest from working our way to heaven. And yet Satan has turned and taken the symbol of rest from works and has turned it into a work. That just surprises me and just... I, as a psychology teacher across the street here, I am surprised at the absurdity of Christianity. I am surprised at the first shall be last and the last shall be first. By giving, we gain. By hoarding, we lose. Jesus' very clear message on this. Psychologically, it doesn't make sense, but it works. And every time it works, it just surprises me. And why should I be surprised? Because I'm not a good servant. If my master has said this works, shouldn't I believe what my master has said? This works. I am surprised to realize that when we harm someone else, we harm ourselves even more so. Every time we do something hurtful to another, the surprising thing is the person who has really been hurt is you or me, because we have lessened ourselves. I have never taught homiletics. I've often wondered what it would be like to teach homiletics, to try to teach other students how to preach. I know one of the main rules in the homiletics books, that at least what I learned when I was in the seminary, was that when you develop a sermon, at the most you should only have 3 points. At the most. And I have discovered in life that it's really difficult for people to remember 3 points. You go home to church, somebody says to you, what was the sermon about? How many times you can't remember even 1 point, let alone 3? Yeah, you're right, yeah. So I sort of had taken the stance through the years, no. A good sermon doesn't have 3 points, it only has one. Just one. And this morning I have now gone through 15 points. Indicating to you that this is probably the world's worst ever, ever, ever sermon you have ever, ever heard. Because I have more than violated every rule this morning. So I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. I'm going to ask you to please forget everything that I have just... Actually, I don't have to ask you that. I know you've already forgotten everything. No, instead of... I'm going to ask you to please, please remember that right now, the sermon this morning is going to begin right now. And it's only going to have 1 point. I am so surprised that Jesus loves us.
Thank you.
May the God of all surprises carry you safely through this week with the assurance in your heart that you are saved forever. Amen.